Okay. Now. So, as promised, let's address that. Hugh? Oh, Hugh. Let us forget what you've heard, known, and even what you've learned of the man from this series. Let's see if we can help you behold him, Hugh MacRae, as human. A person. Another living, breathing, feeling. Homo sapien. In fact, let's examine that family tree. And the whole dang MacRae clan, as it were. The international to local family history. Shall we? Let's do.
I was born 10,000 years ago. There's nothing in this world I don't know.
Firstly, in the year our Lord 443 AD, the islanders established a name as MacRae. Studies report the earliest account is a man, MacRae the Wise. The word was frequently used as the personal name of lords, and more significantly, the ecclesiastics, or priests. The name, MacRae, first appeared in Scotland in the 10th century. They later evolved into the actual MacRae clan. No matter how it's spelled or pronounced, MacRae, 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 and so on, same clan. A complicated bloodline, the name literally translates as men, women, people, of grace. Among them are many poets, authors, and artists, but also soldiers and warriors. Plus, as mentioned, primarily individuals of the cloth and people of faith. Subsequently, they have a history of passionate war on behalf of their religion and ideologies, having several occur through time. The 1200s, the 1400s, etc.
The soldier fray, the war's great hands, the sailor fray, the
man. The earliest recorded man with this name is
Christopher MacRae, then Finney de MacRae, then another Christopher MacRae, and another Finney de MacRae III, and yet another Christopher Gillyclois de MacRae, and then John MacRae, but still another Christopher MacRae, the Reverend John MacRae, then there was a Reverend Farquhar MacRae, 1580 to 1662, Constable of Ellendon Castle, Vicar of Clitheroe, then the first Alexander MacRae the Variante, and the first Hugh MacRae, 1661 to 1730, then John MacRae, 1666 to 1715. Commonly known as John of Contra, he was one of the famous four Johns of Scotland, so called by Highlanders for their valour at the Battle of Sheriffmuir.
Note, remember this one, it's essential to understanding the motives of Hugh MacRae.
Roderick MacRae, 1692 to 1790. The MacRae family lived in Scotland for centuries. Before Roderick MacRae immigrated from Inverness Shire to Wilmington, North Carolina in 1770. For those who care to, can note that he was an immigrant.
He's taken to the field with his wife.
He spoke Gaelic.
He's a runt and a robin lad.
More guilt.
A brisk and a bonny lad.
And had a fondness for traditional haggis.
To follow the laddie with the white cock up.
Two of his sons fell, fighting for the pretender at Culloden. He gives birth to a son, Colin. Though Roderick eventually made his way to Chatham County, his grown son, Colin, moved to Cumberland. Colin gave birth to Alexander.
There was a soldier, a Scottish soldier.
Alexander MacRae, 1796 to 1868. He fought in the war with England in 1812. A man of 70 years, he was appointed major and commanded what became known as MacRae's battalion. By 1814, Alexander lived in Wilmington. He commanded the 1st Battalion of North Carolina Heavy Artillery in the Cape Fear area. His residence, Dumagan Castle, was located on the southeast corner of Front and Princess, until a fire damaged it in 1840, and he moved to 420 Orange, onto his death in 1868. Like several of his descendants, Alexander was a talented civil engineer. He helped plan the construction of the Wilmington and Weldon Railroad, and served as president of that railroad and the Wilmington and Manchester Line. General Alexander, the oldest officer in the Confederate Army, had 9 sons, most of whom served in the Civil War. Though the accomplishments of his kids were impressive, son Donald, father to Hugh MacRae, had the most vital Wilmington connection.
Donald MacRae, 1825 to 1892. The first MacRae of this bloodline born in Wilmington, at his father's Dumagan Castle. He was a trifle below the average stature, only 5 feet 7, and 125 pounds. But he was a business heavyweight, president of Wilmington Cotton Mills, and Wilmington Compress. He also had financial interests in banks, railroads, Florida real estate, and 5 blockade runners. D. MacRae was a commission merchant until 1861, when he devoted time to manufacturing iron, cotton goods, and fertilizer. In addition, he served as area British vice consul, and was a strong advocate for public schools. Surprisingly, it may be interesting to know He was also president of the Thalian Association. He was a good mimic and actor, even above the average of amateurs. Donald was witty and entertaining in conversation, and his reading, often instructive. There was sometimes a sting to his satire, but no malice. And as his sense of humor was very strong, never tiresome in his talks. He had the courage of his convictions and the combativeness to defend them to the last ditch. When he made up his mind, it was a unit. There were no loopholes, no ragged joints, no incomplete opinions. His deductions were clear, logical, practical. No fallacy nor sophistry could blind him. Donald MacRae was genius in construction, arrangements, colors and combinations. As well, like his father, grand and great-grandfather, he had that old Highland enthusiasm and had never learned to let go. The clan feeling was firm in his nature, and he resented any slight cast upon his relatives, but had enough of the old Scotch pride to conceal his deeper emotions. He married Elizabeth Savage and had one daughter. After his wife died of illness, he married Julia from Boston, of the well-to-do and elegant surname of Norton's. They had six children, and he was a model father and companion. In the MacRae family, he was the keystone, binding all together. Was never demonstrative, but was sincerely genial and affectionate.
One of his sons, Captain Donald MacRae, 1861-1928, was the commanding officer of the Wilmington Light Infantry.
There was a soldier.
But the most recognized of his children, by far, is Hugh. Hugh MacRae I, 1865-1951.
Let's call him Hugh I. His career would mix technology, financial brilliance, and give him entree to many of the nation's rich and famous, including Presidents Roosevelt and Wilson. He was also known to make quiet gifts to those in need. He was a miner, developer, and innovative agriculturist. He owned his own bank in Wilmington and maintained a branch in New York. He was possessor of the Tidewater Power Company, the Oceanic Hotel, the Streetcar System, Harbor Island Pavilion, Lumina Station, and about 70,000 acres of New Hanover, Hender, and Columbus counties. He also possessed considerable western North Carolina acreage, which includes Grandfather Mountain. Interesting fact. Through his Carolina Trucking Development Company, Hugh I created six agricultural colonies, peopled by farmers recruited from abroad. Marathon settled with Polish immigrants, Van Aden and Castle Hayne settled by Hollanders, St. Helena, a colony near Bigor, settled with Italians, and Ardesia, occupied by Hollanders and Poles. The sixth, Van Aden colony, failed the first time. So he and Dr. Alvin Johnson of New York resettled the land in the late 1930s with Jewish Holocaust escapees. MacRae once conceived that various ethnic broods might serve as the better labor forces of Wilmington, and could possibly end reliance on the African and Euro-American workers, while shifting the burdens to peoples he felt more suited for farming. Whereby, he'd reframe the entire governance of farming in the South. Unlike H.W. Grady of Georgia, who wanted to replace farming with factory in the South, Hugh I devised that it shouldn't be eliminated, but shifted. Reordered. Reassigned.
Clever, he thought.
It was his version of a new South. Of his three children, he only had one beloved son, for which he has much hope, being the only male heir.
Nelson MacRae, 1893-1942. Nelson also gave birth to only one male, only one child in fact. Hugh, his father's namesake.
Hugh MacRae II, let's refer to him as Hugh II.
When I was a wee thing,
Hugh II's maternal grandparents, Mr. and Mrs. John Bellamy, lived at 602 Market. The mansion had a third floor ballroom where he could run about, and there was always lots of good southern food around, like fried chicken, gotten straight from the backyard coop. Too fondly recalls that life at the Bellamy's house always had a relaxed southern air. But in my grandfather's house, Hugh I, things were more formal. My great-grandmother, wife of Donald MacRae, was Julia from Boston, so her composure was elegant there, and became part of the MacRae house, 717 Market Street, the homestead mentioned in part 3. Hugh II attended St. Paul's School in Concord, New Hampshire, before entering Princeton in 1942. World War II beckoned, and he enlisted in the U.S. Air Force in 43, where he learned to fly B-17s, though the war ended before the young captain had time to fly a mission. In 46, he graduated from Princeton, and earned a degree in commerce from UNC in 1950. He then returned to Wilmington to work for his grandfather, Hugh I, and with his cousin, Hugh Morton. Hugh MacRae Morton, 1921-2006. Hugh Morton, whose stellar career would become legendary, attended Episcopal High School in Virginia, before enrolling at Chapel Hill. World War II interrupted his schooling, and he enlisted in the Army. Morton became enamored with photography at 13, and published his first photograph in Time magazine at 14. The Army acknowledged his expertise by making him a newsreel photographer. It was not a job for sissies. He was awarded the Bronze Star and Purple Heart. Morton married Julia Taylor and had four children. The family divided their time between the Port City and Linville, until 74, when they moved to the base of Grandfather Mountain. While carefully preserving its natural beauty, Morton transformed the mountain into an international tourist draw. He dreamed up the Mile High Bridge, extended the road to the top of the mountain, built the visitor's center, and promoted a black mountain bear he named Mildred. Later, he celebrity hosted Singing on the Mountain, plus created a series of much distributed postcards from his own spectacular photos. His work was flawless and earned him numerous national awards. He authored several photo anthologies, and eventually published pictures in virtually every crucial magazine in America. He was less known as a filmmaker, but he did beautiful work. Among other titles, he created the documentary, The Search for Clean Air, which PBS stations nationwide would feature. Morton's influence is all around us. He was the person who persuaded our state government to plant wildflowers along our highways. He was chairman of the commission to bring the battleship USS North Carolina to Wilmington. He helped the Hilton chain build a hotel on the Cape Fear River. And he even had a hand in bringing a quiet North Carolina boy into the spotlight. When he asked Andy Griffith to entertain the Press Association in 1950, Griffith, an unknown, was paid $25. By the following year, he was playing on Broadway. Hugh Morton followed his beloved Carolina Tar Heels and was a fixture at the press table throughout his life. In 82, the festival scheduled him to crown Linda Goodfriend, Queen Azalea, but Morton asked them to change plans. He had just witnessed UNC freshman Michael Jordan's athletic feats, particularly his winning shot in the NCAA tournament. Sensing Jordan was on the verge of worldwide celebrity, Morton asked to pass the crown to Jordan at the coronation. They accepted. Morton delighted ever after retelling the story of the night he made an assist to Michael Jordan.
Let's turn back to Hugh too. Hugh MacRae II, 1924-2018. He rarely missed a day of work. Even at a spry 93 years, he was still coming and going daily to and from the Oleander Company Incorporated, OCI. He was first employed with his family real estate firm in 48, until the company's dissolution in 52, upon the death of Hugh I. He then formed his own company. OCI is responsible for the residential development of South Forest Hills, South Oleander, Lincoln Forest, Piney Woods, and some parts of Riotsville Beach. The commercial property developments included Hanover Center, Independence Mall, and other investments in the Port City, Brunswick County, and Linville, North Carolina. He was a pillar of his community, and he absolutely loved Wilmington.
The following are excerpts from an essay on the photos of Hugh Morton, titled, Hugh MacRae at Inverashiel, by David S. Jegelski and Timothy B. Tyson, co-editors of Democracy Betrayed, The Wilmington Race Riot of 1898 and Its Legacy.
We can't stop looking at Hugh Morton's photographs of his grandfather. We see these fond images through our own eyes, as grateful grandsons, adoring sons, and as loving fathers who want to be grandfathers ourselves. We also see them, though, as historians. That's one reason why they're so arresting to our eyes. These images of Hugh MacRae seize our attention. Hugh I was a central figure in the terrible racial massacre, the campaign of which was the capstone of all American white supremacy. Though he remains a singularly important historical figure, neither of us had even seen a photograph of him before. But these photos seized us in a language more human than historical. It was powerful and provocative to see the warmth in his eyes.
We love our grandfathers and our fathers. We relish their stories and miss their company, their shortcomings, their misdeeds, their character deficiencies. Do not define them.
And so it was oddly ironic for two historians to appreciate and perhaps even envy these tender moments between the two Hugh MacRaes. That's what fascinates us about Morton's grandfather, having learned so much about him. His portraits are absolutely arresting. They peer into the roots of many of our current racial dilemmas, and into the past we've inherited. His grandfatherly visit creates a moment for meditation on the nature of good and evil. And yet we're not entirely sure why we can't stop looking. All we can say with confidence is that caught in the lens of a loving grandson's camera, the Hugh MacRae we see is a gentle, wise-looking old man who looks a lot like family. In fact, who looks a lot like us.
Through seven generations, leaders of the MacRae family have exhibited the best of the old Scottish work ethic, while executing some of the most creative business ideas Cape Fear has ever known. The clan's descendants are intensely proud of their Scottish heritage. Even the family farm, Invershile, is named after a small village in Scotland. Hugh, too, is a proud member of the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St. Andrews in Scotland. In the early 70s, he sought permission from John MacRae in Contra to start a Clan MacRae Society of North America. John of Contra granted, and too is its president. Most of the MacRae men have kilts hanging in their closets.
Follow the laddie with the white cock on.
Remember this man, Roderick MacRae? Staunch in his Scottish identity, he had always known of the Scottish Wars of Independence, and just witnessed firsthand the most honored of Scottish uprising, the Jacobite Rebellion, fought in 1745.
He's taken to the field with his white cock on.
Roderick migrated from Scotland to Wilmington in 1770, only 25 years later. And through his blood lineage, he passed that old Scotch pride and fight along to his descendants. From Cologne, to Alexander, to Donald, and then to Hugh I.
The clan mentality reigns supreme in the mind of Hugh MacRae I. Thus his far-sighted ability to perceive an entire race of people as a single component. To him, tribalism was a thing to be valued, a brotherhood to capitalize upon one another's strengths, or sisterhood to be supported with the other's falter, even utilized. An isolated species he could make into local colonies, i.e., the Italians, the Dutch, the Poles, the Jewish escapees, etc. But, put in more realistic terms, Hugh I had the short-sighted inability to perceive all of humankind as a race within itself. Only different colors and cultures who can capitalize and support in similar ways as their singular unit. But all the same, humanhood, all people. Because the clan mob concept had been so successful in Scotland, their collective zeal so robust, and their pugnacious plot so treacherous, when it came to the African Americans as a whole, Hugh thought, let's just eliminate them, be done, and move forward. So as a European people, they moved against them. But unlike Alfred Whitale, the other Confederate officers, even the nobles and noblemen, Hugh I did not yearn for a return to the old South. Far from it. He was a sophisticated, visionary leader, a gifted entrepreneur, and a percipient builder. He had already taken part in making this practically utopian port city and beaches into a land of beautiful properties. He then wanted to help make his town within it, and around it, plus his villages, into a kingdom. By imploring the latest technologies and proven mechanical industry, he'd mold it into what the site eventually became. The model southern city of churches and schools. But only for his people. And those like them. For the Scots. And other Europeans.
But this is America. Not Scotland. And the clan mob mentality doesn't and won't work here. It can't. The concept itself goes against the very grain and fiber of what it means to be a democracy. Democracy. A system of government by the whole population, all the members of the state, typically through elected representatives. So, killing the citizens, and acquiring office by gunpoint. It's not gonna go so well. And if it does, which it did for the White Declaration of Independence in Wilmington, you can't tell anyone. Hence, the virtual bubble. But after a few decades of Scottish and European absolute rule, it's completely undone by something as simple, as practical, as ethically moral, as school integration. Wow. So, beholding Hugh MacRae I as an actual human being is not to make excuses, nor justify his means, not even trying to get all Kanye on ya. But to offer deeper insight into the man and his motives.
Hugh I felt his power diminishing, and to the staunch Scottish tribalist mindset of the times, what do you do if someone or something is taking your power? If a Northerner influenced fusionist party is halting your unique and seemingly clever governance for a new South? You rally the Southerners to your defense, regardless the restoration they prefer. The outdated, impractical antebellum, he thought. No matter, the southerner objective. You stop the movement. Or destroy the movers. By any means necessary. So he did.
Final thought on the matter. What perchance perceived by some as part of his karmic retribution is that the vice president of his company, his beloved and singular male heir, Hugh MacRae I's only begotten son,
Nelson MacRae, is reported to have committed suicide, shot himself in the bathroom of his Oleander home while the other occupants were out. For years, this was challenging to uncover. Out of respect for the man, and regard for the family and their innumerable contributions, the local news and press covered the story very, very little to none. In fact, the only easily accessible public record of the account is this single article from a Fayetteville paper. Who knows what might have driven Nelson to take his own life? He's the only son of one of the most influential figures in North Carolina. Perhaps it was the guilt and shame of his father's past doing. Perhaps something unbearable within his marriage, or among his family. It's rumored to be some other, more nefarious than suicide. Perhaps that. And maybe it's just none of these. But what is outlined by the truth of this social-political novelty is that no amount of money or power insulates you from the unforgiving starkness of one's truest reality.
Not for son. Not for father. That salvation is apparently acquired through some other means entirely. Oh, that Hugh. One rarely hears reports of a family so heartily glowing, and yet so vile. They're like the blissful, but tragic, but blissful saga of a Shakespeare royal family. Because they are treasures, brilliance, scheming misdeeds, mysterious death, castles and all. They are. In conclusion, one of the most sobering and simplistically profound sentiments ever stated of Hugh MacRae the First, and the sometimes inspiring, sometimes indignifying, and often exasperating matters surrounding him, the advantageous and calamitous results of his choices and actions, of which we're all left to ponder, can be found at the bottom of the Soselsky Tyson essay. In the comments section below, historian scholar Anne Wisnant writes,
"All of us are filled with often vexing and irreconcilable contradictions. It behooves us not to forget that about ourselves or about those who become widely acclaimed and revered."
The name MacRae is well known to Wilmingtonians, but few are aware of the family's longevity in the community and their unsurpassed endowments. The most notable is the sprawling pine forest off Oleander. Hugh I donated it in 1913, a restrictive covenant declared it could only be for white citizens. The city named it Hugh MacRae Park after his death in 51.
In 97, Hugh II began his own personal efforts to heal the wounds of 1898. He joined forces with Bertha Todd, a well-known African-American community activist, and has contributed time and money to the memorial. "I admire his courage," said Todd, "because he stepped forward in the early years and has continued to support our efforts." He also symbolically and warmly opened Hugh MacRae Park to all people. He has been a good friend.
Meg MacRae Bellamy, Hugh I's great-granddaughter, is the first direct descendant to publicly state,
"I don't speak for anybody else, but I think it's really important. The last thing that needs to happen is more defending of the park's name. I don't want to feel like I'm speaking out against my family. I'm not against them, but I am for equality, justice, and reform."
The son of Hugh II, Hugh III, Hugh MacRae III, has often provided generous subsidies toward the 1998 causes. He suggests that the current MacRae families, at least, don't share the reluctance many people have to an honest assessment of our past.
With this resolve, and other hopeful tidbits throughout the series, holding salient space in our minds and hearts, let's make prayer and petition that Wilmington can return to its most honorable civil union. The place is still one of the wealthiest in the state, and economists register as the more upper to middle class of the country. So let's try to make addition to the prosperity and restore to some of that multiculturalism. Regain some of that social civic ingenuity. Recapture some of that newer, greater society and beyond.
What if we, as a humanity, not only both races, or both parties, but all the parties and races, every man, woman, and child, and not only of this country, but worldwide, every single person alive, could be better. Decided we would do something just a little better. Be just a little kinder. A tiny, tiny bit more compassionate and understanding. Just a little. Things as a whole would be just a little better. Life itself more palatable. Human interaction more tolerable. The absolute spiritual film we have wrapped around this globe could experience just a little energetic, kinetic, even genetic lift to a higher vibration, one that feels just a little better. What if we all decided that we could do that? Wouldn't it be better? A tiny, tiny bit? Yeah. Yep. Now, what if we decided we could do that again and again? Then over and over. Just saying.